All right, we are now recording. Okay. So, good evening, everybody. Welcome to the deep dive Bible study into the book of Mark. It's October 23rd, today, 2024. And you're here in New Beginnings Christian Missionary Alliance Church in Poughkeepsie, New York. I'm Pastor House. Glad to have you guys here. We got a full house here in our horseshoe. You guys online don't know that, but let's just say, we'll do this. Here you go. Ready? Oh, that's as far as I can do it. Oh, no.
Okay. I know.
Yeah. Hi. Hello. Yeah. All right. So, yeah, lots of people here.
We got a full house there.
And online, we've got about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 online. It sounds like we got more people coming down the hallway. Fantastic. All right. So we're going to pray, and then we'll get started with our study tonight. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you that 2,000 years ago, you sent your Holy Spirit to inspire Mark to write these words, and that you had a point you wanted to get across to the people of Mark's day, and you had a point you wanted to get across to us as well. Thank you even more that you speak through your word to our individual specific lives in our individual specific situations. I pray that you would send your Holy Spirit even now to fill each heart within this room, on Zoom and on YouTube. Folks who are watching on YouTube, Lord, please help us to have a readiness to listen to what you have to say to us today. And a willingness to respond in faith and in trust. Lord, open our eyes, our ears, and our hearts, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 All right. I'm John. Good to see you.
Hey, how you doing?
Is your lovelier half here?
I know she's listening to it. She's sick.
Please come to the weather. Do a little pray for her. Please tell her that we
have a real good time.
All right, just by matter of review, we do this every week. We're doing manuscript Bible study. That means that we are studying the text. The text we have is the English Standard Version, and it is printed out on our pages, 8.5 by 11 pages, double spaced, to give you the space and the opportunity to write all over the thing. Also, we've provided you with markers, pens, pencils, different things to enable you to circle, square, draw connections between things on your sheet. This is all in pursuit of the inductive Bible study method, which uses three steps. Okay, so we're following three steps in our time together tonight. The first step is to observe. We look to see what does the text say, okay? Because what it says determines ultimately what it means. Mark, he wrote this text. Mm-hmm. He wrote it to get a point across, and he used different tools to enable him to get that point across. Tools included, what are some of the strategies that Mark employed to make sure that his point got across?
Repetition,
right? Boy, that's always our first one because it's the best, right? I mean, repetition is the most, I think it's the most fun. I really enjoy it. There's some great repetition in Mark. He'll say things over and over because he wants to make sure that we get the point. Kind of like if you were at a Bible study where every week we talked about observation, interpretation, and application. Honestly, one of my goals is that 10 years from now, if someone shook you in the middle of the night and asked you, what are the three steps of inductive Bible study? You'll be like, oh, observe, interpret, and apply. And then they'll let you go back to sleep. But I want it to be that kind of rote for you because these are important tools that you're going to need for your life with Christ. So first is to observe, asking the question, what does it say? Right? Okay, the second step that we follow is to interpret. I don't know, how do you spell interpret? P-R-E-T. Asking the question, what does is mean, right? We believe that the interpretation is grounded in the observation. We look for what it says because what it says indicates what it means. And when we interpret the text, we are interpreting it based on what we've seen in the observation. We're not interpreting it based on what some other person told us it might mean. We're not interpreting it based on what we feel it should mean. We're interpreting it based on what the text actually says. Now, there's a couple of sort of nuances to that. One is that we also, it's important for us to allow scripture to interpret scripture. Okay? Why? What does that mean? That means that this isn't the only passage written in the Bible ever. Okay? And sometimes other passages of scripture can illuminate the meaning of this text. We start with this text. We observe like crazy in this text. We want this text to tell us what it means. But there, then we check that against the meaning of other texts. Okay? Now, we don't do that every week. But what we are doing every week is adding text onto text onto text onto text onto text. And gradually, we build a mature understanding of what Scripture says. So that when your best friend says, I read the Bible and it says Judas went and hanged himself. And then I open it to another passage and it says, go and do thou likewise. You can say, that's not a proper interpretation of these texts, right? That's not what the text was intended to say to you. That's not how you interpret the Bible. So Scripture is going to interpret Scripture. One of the principles that underlies that is that clear passages interpret opaque passages. Okay? So if you have a passage that clearly states a doctrine or a truth, and another passage that kind of is difficult to discern what it might mean, but it's obviously on the same topic, the clearer passage, generally speaking, has authority to interpret the more opaque passage. So these are just some of the interpretive tools that we use when we're going through texts of Scripture. All right, and the third step, observe, interpret, and then we apply. In applying, we ask, what does it mean to me? Right? And application is actually the step of faith. Okay? When we apply, that's not to say that faith doesn't affect observation and interpretation. It certainly does. But application is where faith meets the road. We have certain core beliefs when we come to Bible study. One of them is that God inspired this text to the people it was written to, but for us as well. Okay, it wasn't written to us. Mark wrote his gospel probably to the Christians who were in Rome after the death of Peter. Okay, that's who he's writing it to. And he had their specific concerns in mind. But it was also written for us. And we believe that God made sure that it was written for us, that we can learn from it, and that it has authority over our lives as well. So when we do the application of the text, what we're saying is, I believe you, God. I believe that you inspired this text so that I might read it and I might learn from it. And I might put it into practice in my life. So application is the step of faith. It is a response of faith. We aren't just studying this text to gain knowledge. We're not just trying to find out curiosities about first century religion. What we're trying to do is to find out what God wants from us today. And one of the weird things about Christianity is we believe that that comes from a 2,000-year-old book, right? And, you know, we get mocked for that in the culture, right? Take your cues from a 2,000-year-old book. written to people, you know, halfway across the world, really. We've advanced since then. We, you know, this is the modern world. Get with the program. And so it's a step of faith for us to say, yeah, it is 2,000 years old. Yeah, it was written to people halfway across the globe. And yet God intended for it to be used for me today. Okay, that's the step of faith. It's not a step of faith that's easy to take for everybody, right? It's not easy to take ultimately for anybody, because there's going to be things in the text that call us into question. We don't study the text because it makes us feel better about ourselves, or if so, you're not really paying close attention. The text is always looking into our lives, and God is using it to pry apart the things that are stuck in us, to cut out the things that are damaged in us and broken, and to heal us to be more like him. God is using the text like a surgeon to heal and correct. So we do the application because we believe. Now, I'm going to say this probably primarily for those of you on YouTube, because I know the folks in this room and I know the folks who are on Zoom. Maybe you don't believe these things about the text. Here's my appeal to you, and that is give it a shot. Give it a shot. I'm always encouraging people who don't believe to just test it out, to talk to God and say, okay, I'm going to look into this text. And if you want to talk, if you're real and you want to talk to me through this text, then do it. Okay. Give it a shot and see what God does through it. My wager to you is that God wants to speak to you today. I believe there's a real God. He wants to speak to you today. So give it a try and see if he's got something to say to you. You might be glad you did. Right? All right. So observe, interpret, apply. Any questions from around the room or on Zoom? You've all heard this now multiple times. But still, if there's questions or comments, happy to hear. All right, we're going to dive into our study today. So if you're joining us online and you don't have a manuscript, send an email to church@newbeginningscma.org, and we'll send a copy of the manuscript to you. In the meantime, we're looking at Mark chapter 10, and I don't remember what the verse is, verse 32. In our manuscript, it is page 5, line 7. Page 5, line 7. We stopped at page 5, line 7, but many who are first will be last, and the last first was the last thing that we looked at. So we're starting with, and they were on the road going up to Jerusalem. Some of you had the chance in this past week to read ahead and see what the text is about as we're going in. Our first interpretive question is, where do we break this passage? Where do we stop our passage for tonight? So I want to throw it out there. What did you guys find? Where do you think this passage should end tonight?
And I have page 6, line 5.
Page 6, line 5, give his life as a ransom for many. Why did you stop there?
Because it says, and they came to Jericho, and as he was leaving Jericho, the disciples kind of like,
it's a change of scene.
Change of scene, you know.
Yeah, very good. Okay, that makes sense.
I said line 15.
Okay.
His sight and followed him on the way.
Why did you say 15?
I don't know. The other one didn't look long enough.
That's the practical question.
And then I thought that it was an example with the blind man of what he was just talking about, how he serves.
I think you're right. I think you're right. Maybe did anybody have a different spot, either other than 5 or 15?
On page six.
I was ready to stop at 5. Okay. That was my first thought. And I just read ahead, and as I read ahead, I saw a couple of things that made me think, we got to go to 15. So 5 is a logical place to stop, okay? That's a perfectly good place to stop. But I think we're going to see some things if we go to 15 that we would miss if we left that for the next study. Okay, so let's go up through 15 on line six, on page six. He recovered his sight and followed him on the way. And I'm going to want you to take now 5 minutes on your own. Good job, Emily. Take five. Take 5 minutes now. And I want you to use the pens, pencils, markers on your table. And I want you to observe in this text. You're looking for repetition, cause and effect, comparison and contrast, a list. We're looking for repeated words, ideas, phrases. You're looking for anything that stands out to you as interesting. Mark it up. When I used to teach manuscript Bible study to college students, we always did the Gospel of Mark, and we always said, mark it up. Get it? Mark it up. Come on, that's awful. All right, take 5 minutes, and then we're going to get together again and share our observations.
All right, that's been 5 minutes.
Glad I had that time. All right. So here's what I'd like to ask you. All right, we're gonna answer the observation question. What did you see? What did you see in the text? What did you observe? What things stood out to you? One of the principles that we have for Bible study, and this is, you know, kind of weird, but we say, read it till it's weird. There's got to be a reason that Mark wrote this down, okay? If there were things that Jesus did every day, right? He probably had breakfast. He probably brushed his teeth. No, probably didn't brush his teeth. Probably, you know, got dressed and packed up his clothes, and Mark doesn't record any of that stuff, right? That's normal. What Mark records are the things that are not normal. There are things that happen that are weird, that are unusual, that are strange. And sometimes, because we've heard sermons about these things so many times and read them in Bible studies so many times, we don't see how weird it is. The longer you're a Christian, the less weird it seems. So we use observation to help us see how weird it is, okay? So what stood out to you? The things that stand out to you are often the things that are weird. Joe?
What stood out to me most, I think, was Jesus said, your religious leaders are going to turn me over to the Gentiles, convict me, condemn me, mock me, torture me, and kill me. And the apostles' response was, we want you to do whatever we ask.
Yeah, okay. So there's a bit of a disconnect, right? There's a bit of a disconnect there. So that's an interesting, weird thing, right? That is, Jesus talks about his upcoming death in very detailed terms, okay? So let's bracket this off just for a second. Has Jesus talked about his death in Jerusalem before?
Yes.
Where?
At least two times before.
Okay. Yeah. So we've seen it on page 2, for example, of this current manuscript, line 16 and 17. What did he say there? He said, "The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And when he is killed, after 3 days, he will rise." Okay. And the disciples understood that clearly and accepted it with joy. Right. They did not understand it, and they were afraid to ask him to tell them more. Right. And there is another one, and I didn't locate it.
And he after that, he asked them, what were you discussing on the way? And they talked about something completely different.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
It's like, let's
right. Which also happened to be sort of status oriented, right? What they said then was, we saw a dude who was casting out demons in your name, and we told him to stop because he wasn't with us. Actually, the other one is on page 1 of your current manuscript, line 10. Jesus and his three closest disciples are coming down the mountain after the transfiguration, and he says, he charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. And they questioned. They kept them at it themselves, questioning what this rising from the dead might mean. They ask him a question that seems kind of theological, and then Jesus says, it is written of the Son of Man that he should suffer many things and be treated with contempt. Okay, so Jesus has twice now predicted his upcoming death. Twice before, he's also predicted his resurrection, and all three times, the disciples have not understood what he was talking about. Okay. It is par for the course here, but the disciples have a real disconnect on this topic. They are not ready to hear this, even though Jesus is saying it extremely clearly. What else did you see?
Pastor?
Yes, Bev.
Even before that, going to Jerusalem, Jesus was walking ahead of them, and they were amazed.
Okay.
Amazed that he was, I had the question, were they amazed that he was walking in front of them, and those that followed were afraid?
Okay. Good job, Bev. This is really good. This is one of those areas where it's really easy to not see how weird this is. Okay. Right. Jesus walked ahead of them. Is that weird? I don't know. We don't really have much, not really much descriptions about who usually went first when they were walking on the road. I'm not sure what that is. But then it says, and they were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. So what is that about? What are they amazed about and afraid about?
Who's the they?
Okay.
First.
Good. So who's the they? That's a great question. We have in line 7, we have, and they were on the road going up to Jerusalem. Who's that they? All of them, probably. It's Jesus and his companions. And Jesus was walking ahead of them. Who's that them?
12.
Probably the same, yeah?
The 12 and the disciples?
Probably.
Or just the 12 apostles?
So that's the question we're trying to answer, right?
Okay.
It's vague enough that it probably means everybody who's following along, right? But then there's a distinction made between two different groups that are following Jesus, right? And they were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. Talk to me about that.
I think it's because they are thinking about the many who were first will be last and last first.
Okay.
So they're wondering where they fit in, and that's scary.
It could be. So it could be that the amazement and the fear has to do with the conclusion of the previous passage, yeah. Right? There is no one who has left brothers, sisters, mothers, father, children, and lands will not receive it 100-fold now in this time, and in the age to come, eternal life with persecutions. The many who are first will be last, last first. Maybe that's it. Maybe it's the fact that it's impossible to be saved without the work of God. The rich people can't enter the kingdom of heaven on their own. Maybe that's it. It's a possibility. Other possibilities.
It's an all Jewish, first century audience. So we're talking about people for whom the sacrificial system is still applying.
Mm-hmm.
So they were looking at this.
That statement.
I'm sorry, I can't.
You know, maybe the people who were made, if it's about the previous statements, if it's about that, maybe it's the people who,
brothers and sisters.
Right, all that, maybe it's the people who have a lot to lose.
Maybe. Maybe they're afraid that,
if that's what it's about.
Just like the young man that had been talked to in the previous story, maybe. Yeah, maybe. It also might be that they're going to Jerusalem.
Yes.
So that's the closest reference. Okay. So it's good to look at the closest reference and see if that solves the problem. If it doesn't, then we go a little farther away. Is there anything amazing and frightening about their going up to Jerusalem?
Well, it's frightening because Jesus keeps telling them that he's going to get killed.
Okay.
He can't make it any clearer.
Okay.
So now it's starting to sink in, like, whoa. So
that's a possibility.
Twice.
Right? This is a possibility. A possibility is that Jesus has been, now he's about to say it more explicitly than ever. But he's already said it at least a couple of times that Jerusalem, and that actually he doesn't say Jerusalem in any of the previous ones. So it's only in this saying that he will specify this is going to happen in Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't take a rocket surgeon to realize that if opposition is going to come, it's going to happen in Jerusalem. They've been experiencing what Jesus has been experiencing. Mm-hmm. So there's a possibility that Jerusalem is where this is all going to happen.
Yeah. And he mentioned the chief priests and scribes, and that's where they work, right?
Yes. Was that in the previous ones?
Yeah. Before he told them that.
In the previous one, it says he'll be delivered into the hands of men. And the one before that says He will suffer many things and be treated with contempt. So prior to this, he had not specified it with the chief priests and the scribes. Although
I retract my suggestion.
Although, again, it might not be, it's not impossible that they anticipated that that's where the opposition would come from, because they've been experiencing opposition along the way.
I would equate it to, you know, they went to Pleasant Valley, they went to LaGrange, now they're going to New York City.
Yeah,
and they're like, whoa, we're going
big time.
Big time.
Yeah, maybe.
And Jesus is ahead of everyone. He's going faster than everyone.
Yes. So to me, when I'm looking at this, what tips the question for me is that Jesus is walking ahead of them, which indicates sort of a purposefulness or an eagerness. And that purposefulness and eagerness is frightening to them. Okay, that they're going to Jerusalem. He is leading the way. He's striding forward. He's at the front, and it's frightening to them because they can sense that something is coming. There's a lot of different possibilities, and none of them are, I don't think, slam dunks. But what tips it for me is that Jesus is walking ahead of them, and that is in itself scary to them because he's going to whatever future is there.
Can I also comment?
Yeah,
other thing that tipped it for me is he often says a parable or does a thing, and then no one quite understands what's going on, and then he pulls his 12 aside and explains it to them. And the fact that in the very next sentence he takes the 12 aside and tells them, we're going up here, this is what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. So it's almost like he is explaining this thing that everybody's amazed and a little afraid of. So
yeah.
It seems like it all ties together.
We didn't answer the them question or the they question. And I suspect that, again, it's not clear enough for me, but probably they is the 12
mm-hmm.
and those who followed are everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not a slam dunk. It could be, there's a bunch of other possibilities for what it could be. Well, it could be the other way around. They could be the crowd and the 12 could be the ones who follow, because followed is an important word in Mark. So I would like you to circle the word followed. And if you come across it again, let me know. Okay. In our passage. Yes.
I think they were amazed. I do think the first they is the 12.
Okay.
And I think they're amazed because Jesus is telling them all the stuff that's going to happen, but they're still going.
Right.
So now they're amazed. Like, why are we going here? Like, they expect Jesus to say, so I'm changing my mind. We're not going to bother going there.
And there's also a small possibility that the saying that follows, and taking the 12 again, he began to tell them what would happen to him, is not supposed to be chronologically after the walk, but maybe before. That passage, that section might be explaining why they're amazed and afraid. Could be. It could be. I don't. Mark isn't always chronological. That's one of the frustrating things about Mark from our perspective, is that we want him to be chronological, but John is much more chronological. Matthew is much more chronological. Mark is much less.
What about Luke?
Luke is pretty chronological. Luke actually, a lot like Mark, Luke likes to gather things by topic. I'd say on a scale of John to, I'd say John is probably the most chronological as far as we can tell. And the rest are kind of less so. Yeah. All right. Good job. What else did you see? Boom, boom, boom.
Well, he was pretty descriptive in everything that was going to be. I got to mock him, they're going to spit on him, they're going to flog him, and they're going to kill him. I mean, can't be any more concise than what that was.
There's no slipping out of this, right? This is a very detailed description of what's going to happen. Now, in a previous passage, we had said, where is that? That would be the page 2. We'd ask the question, who delivered the Son of Man? Into the hands of men. And we toyed with the idea that maybe it was God. So God delivered the Son of Man into the hands of men. Is the same thing happening here with the word will be, with line 11, the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes?
Yeah, it could be.
Could be. What's the other option? If it's not God,
And it's going to be like the soldiers.
Or like maybe Judas, right? Delivers him over into the hands of the chief priests. What about the next use of delivered in line 12? They will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles.
Jeez.
That's definitely the chief priests and the scribes, right? They're going to condemn him. They're going to deliver him over. So there's potentially, anyway, there's a chain of deliverance. God delivers Jesus into the hands of Judas, and Judas delivers Jesus into the hands of the chief priests and the scribes. If that's the case, later we're going to see the chief priests and the scribes deliver him over to the Romans, who ultimately will crucify him.
Does chief priests mean the same thing as Sanhedrin?
I'm going to sit for a sec because my knee is bothering me. So that's a question that would be well answered with our Bible dictionary, which I didn't bring. The chief priests are different than the Sanhedrin. It is a Venn diagram.
So it's an overlap.
There's overlap.
Okay.
The Sanhedrin are a subset of the chief priests.
Okay.
Chief priest is a much vaguer term. Yeah. Okay. What else?
Both James and John were so wrapped up in worldly perception of Jesus as the Messiah that they totally missed them.
Yeah.
Missed it. And they were more concerned about their own position than what they were really asking.
Yeah.
Was not going to happen.
What does it mean to sit at Jesus's right hand and at his left? Why would they ask for that?
You're equal to him.
Hmm?
Be equal to him.
Equal to Jesus?
Positions of power.
The right hand. Yeah.
Is your right hand man is equal to you?
Yeah, like Jesus is on the right hand of God.
That's true. That is true. Typically the right hand is the position of the most esteem.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. And the left hand is the next most esteem in the thing. So for example, John Brulee is the person I most esteem, and Chris is the person I next most esteem. If I'd given you positions to sit in, and I even follow them. So sitting on your right hand and on your left in your kingdom there are positions of great authority, but they're the number two man and the number three man, with Jesus as the number one man. Yeah. What else?
Notice that when James and John said, "Can we have the most honored seats?" Jesus' response was, "You can drink my cup, and you can have my baptism," which I think are both bad things. And then the blind beggar said, asked him for something, and he said, "Yes."
Okay, well, let's get to that in a bit. That's an important. There's a reason why I think these stories belong together, and that's getting at that reason. We'll hang on to that for just a minute. Let's focus in on the James and John story for the moment.
I find it interesting that they said, "We want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." That's like, would you go to your boss and say, "I want you to do for me whatever I ask of you"?
Yeah, right.
Your boss would be like, "What?"
Without giving a reason.
What's that?
They didn't give a reason.
Right.
I'm sure you do want that.
Doesn't everybody want that?
I mean, I don't know. Some of you have had kids, right? I mean, there were times when my kids would come and ask me for something without telling me what it is, you know? But you, as a parent, you're always like, "Well, what is it that you want?" That's sort of a strategy that you use when you're not sure your parent's going to say yes, right?
Sure.
And I think that's the same with James and John. They're not sure Jesus would say yes to their request. So they try to get him to agree to it without hearing what it is, which is interesting.
I have a question before you get there.
Yeah.
Is this the first time that Jesus said anything about rising?
No.
Himself?
No. On page 2, he says he'll rise. Mm-hmm. And page 1, he says he'll rise.
Okay.
But yeah, it's since his trend, his... Since the question, "Who do you say that I am?" at the end of our previous manuscript, Jesus has now started to talk about rising from the dead.
Okay.
And it's confusing for them. They don't understand.
I just thought it was strange that he says that the most important thing, and they have no comment. Like, nobody says, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
Nobody says anything.
It's freaky to them. It's really freaky to them. Yeah. They still think that he is going to his glory, right? They, in line 17, right? Grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory. What's in your glory mean for these two disciples? What do they think is going to happen?
He's going to sit on Caesar's throne, probably.
Yeah, he comes to power and throws him to Romans.
Exactly. Yeah, it's the seat of power. It's his kingdom. When Matthew tells this story, Matthew says, when you come into your kingdom, Matthew puts that in their mouths. Matthew also tells us that they have their ma mask.
Sounds almost like Chinese.
So Mark interviewed Pontius. Mark wasn't one of the 12, but Matthew was, right? So I think that Matthew, in my personal Danish house opinion, Matthew had a couple of things that he was annoyed about. And sort of James and John were two of those things.
Well, it says the 10 began to be indignant.
Yeah.
Matthew was one of those 10.
Matthew was one of those 10, right? Matthew was one of those 10. Yeah. Yeah. What's the question that Jesus asks the two of them?
Are you able
to drink?
Yeah, he does. Before that, line 16.
What do you want me to do for you?
What do you want me to do for you? I want you to circle that. And if you see that come up again, let me know. Yeah, so he asks about the cup and the baptism. Okay, so now we got to put on our Old Testament hats. What is the cup? Jesus is being a little metaphorical to them. Right? Is he saying to them, I need a drink. Let's all drink from the same flagon. No.
Is he referring to his blood?
So that's a possibility that they would never understand, right? But it's possible. But is Jesus going to drink from that cup?
No.
No. So I'm going to say no to that one.
Cup is what's going to happen to him. It's the punishment that he's going to be suffering.
But that seems to be what he's talking about, right? That's when we look at this, he seems to be talking about the suffering he's going to go through.
Mm-hmm.
In the Old Testament, there are frequent references to the cup of God's wrath, okay? Mm-hmm. Drinking the cup of God's wrath to the bottom. And it's a strong possibility that that's what Jesus is referring to here, that he is going to be drinking the cup of God's wrath. And are you able to drink that? And they say, yupper. Do they know what that's what he's talking about?
No.
What do they think the cup is?
Wine.
Wine. Why would they think that?
Because he's gonna be in glory. He's gonna be on his throne. People are gonna bring him wine,
right?
The best wine.
Yeah. So there he is, sitting on the throne, right, left. Here, we'll drink from the same cup, right? It's a cup of celebration. Good point. Yeah. So he's talking cup of wrath. Right. They're talking cup of celebration. Now, Jesus will give them a cup of celebration. Okay, at the Last Supper, right? It turns out that the cup of wrath and the cup of celebration go together, that he's going to drink the cup of wrath so they can have the cup of celebration. So there's going to be that transaction made. But Jesus is talking about his suffering. What about baptism? Isn't baptism good?
It's suffering that he's going to be going through.
Yeah. Baptized.
It could be his death that he's going to suffer.
Death. We use baptism that way too. Even though we use water, every time we do a baptism, what do we say? We say
you go down in the water, you die.
Yes,
and then you come back up, and you
exactly right. So baptism for us, and it takes on the connotations that Jesus is talking about here, a symbolic suffering. But for the disciples, they didn't see it that way. For them, baptism was something celebratory or a washing. And certainly they thought of it as a washing because that's what the word meant. It meant mm-hmm. washing. Some sort of washing to enter into the kingdom, right? Doesn't sound particularly threatening to them. But Jesus knows that in order to get to the kingdom, you got to be washed in suffering. And so they are not ready for that. They think they are, but they're not ready for that. He says, you're going to do it.
Right.
So this is the thing, right? Jesus says, you will drink the cup. You will be baptized with my baptism. But I can't give you those two positions of honor.
This, Pastor, this seems to represent his life as a human on earth, that he was baptized to do this calling that God has him do and to be and drink from the cup of suffering and all that. So it's his life as a man on earth. Can anybody do that?
Well, you know? Certainly nobody can. Nobody has the same calling that Jesus had. But Jesus did say that everyone who follows him will suffer.
Yes.
And so there's something about walking in the way of Jesus that includes suffering.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So that's definitely it. But not to the extent, none of us dies on the cross for everybody's sins. Despite what Kenneth Copeland says. That's one of my little, so I'm sorry, I get sometimes, if you wind me up, I get going. But Kenneth Copeland is famous for having said that he could have died for everyone's sins. That if he just had enough faith, he could have died for everyone's sins, which is like, sometimes you just want to grab Kenneth by the lapels, the gold, solid gold lapels, and tell him, you get into your limousine, drive back to your mansion, and leave us alone. Okay. Sorry, I apologize.
That's your cup of wrath.
That's my pet peeve. Oh, those weirdos are making money off the gospel. Anyway, all right. So when the 10 heard it, they're indignant at James and John. And is Jesus okay with that? With them being indignant at James and John? No, because he calls them all the principal's office. Yeah, we can always back up.
I was completely confused by the prior sentence there about saying, but to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but for those to whom it has been prepared.
Whoa!
What is that mean? Completely threw me.
Good question. Any thoughts?
Yeah, he's telling him that it's God's authority and power to grant, which sits on the right, to hand out the crown, say, which sits on.
Well, there definitely is a sense here in which the person who prepared it is not Jesus, right? So he's
rewards will be
passing the question up the chain to God the Father, right? So it's been prepared, but not by Jesus. It's been prepared. Who are those people?
He gives no indication who they are or how they were chosen.
I think like
for whom it's been prepared based on qualifications that it's not revealed.
That's the best I got.
Could be Moses and Elijah.
Could be Moses and Elijah, sure. They appeared with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. Maybe. But Jesus doesn't, there's nothing here to indicate who those people are. So I don't know. And when we let scripture interpret scripture, it is not said anywhere else. So I don't know. I can only guess, and it would be a bad guess probably. Okay. I would guess my wife and Kenneth Copeland. No.
Tongue in cheek.
Yeah, sorry. Benny Hinn and Kenny Copeland. All right.
In some sense, it's already been decided, right? He's not for him to, he's preordained in the sense that it has been prepared.
It has been prepared. So there's forethought here. None of this is accidental. Mm-hmm. Yeah, good point. Before we leave this page, there's one thing I want you to tell me. Walk through with me, what are the ways in which Jesus is, what are the titles by which Jesus is referred to in this passage
so far.
Son of Man is one. Jesus refers to himself that way.
Yeah.
How do we know Son of Man is him, by the way?
He's been referring to himself.
Yeah.
It's in capitals. Okay. Thank you, translators. In the previous line, it says, began to tell them what was to happen to him. And then he described what's going to happen to the Son of Man. So there is complete identification with the Son of Man and Jesus in those two lines. So Son of Man
that was clear to them as well.
It must be, yeah.
Yeah, because he's said that many times by now.
He's been using it as a term of self-description. Yeah.
But he also said, I'm going to die several times, and that's not clear to them.
I know.
But if he said that, let's go get a pizza, they can hear that. So Son of Man.
It's called
teacher. Teacher is another. Yeah. Yeah, good. And Jesus is the other thing. So those are three titles or names of Jesus in this passage so far. If you see any others, let me know. Let's go into page 6.
What about the sacrificial lamb that's going to be killed?
Is that in this passage? I don't remember that.
Yeah. I mean, it doesn't say it, but could we read into it?
So yeah, I mean, I think there's other passages that refer to Jesus as the Lamb of God. He's called the Passover Lamb. There's many, many other descriptions of Jesus, but I'm just interested in this passage. How is Jesus being referred to?
Page 6, line 8, Jesus, Son of David.
Jesus, Son of David. Okay. So this is a biggie, right? He's referred to as Son of David twice. Has he been referred to as the Son of David earlier in the Gospel of Mark that you remember?
No,
is the correct answer. He is actually going to be referred to as the Son of David one more time in the Gospel of Mark later, but this is the first two times that he's referred to. In Matthew, he's called Son of David everywhere. Like Matthew uses it 12 times to talk about Jesus. Mark and Luke each use it 3 times. John doesn't use it at all. It is not an Old Testament term. I did a search. It does show up. If you search for Son of Man in the Old Testament, of Son of David in the Old Testament, you will find it to describe Solomon, Son of David, and one other one of his sons.
Oh, yeah, obviously.
But that's just like physical offspring.
Yeah.
So Jesus is the blind man, Bartimaeus, refers to Jesus as the Son of David. And in Mark, this stands out as a really odd form of address.
Well, it's interesting because it's like, is this guy a genealogist? How did he know that? He was blind, but he could, you know.
Yeah, blind people have mystical powers. Didn't you know that?
Well, it just makes their other 4 senses that much enlightened.
And including their genealogies. So, possibilities for what the Son of David means. One is, Jesus is related to David. That's what Andy is saying. Okay, and in that case, how does the man know?
Well, the Messiah was supposed to be the Son of David.
So it was supposed to be out from the lineage. Okay.
All right. So possibility 2, he's using the term to refer to the Messiah.
Yeah.
The next time we see Son of David in the Gospel of Mark, that will be its reference. Okay. Jesus will say to somebody, say to a crowd, to say, if the Messiah is supposed to be the Son of David, why does David call him his Lord? Okay? So that's reference that we'll see later in the Gospel of Mark. But, and so this has a strong contention to be what the blind man means. If the blind man calls Jesus Messiah,
right,
what does that tell you? What why is that important?
He has a lot of faith.
There's faith in him. Yeah.
And he's figured out something most people haven't.
Yes. Right. This is something that pretty much nobody else has figured out, that Jesus is the Messiah. Here's another fun thing. I think this is what he means.
Oh,
I think Messiah is what he means. But here's a fun thing. I know you didn't bring your big Bibles. You did. You guys did. Okay. Look up for me 2 Samuel 5. Somebody look up 2 Samuel 5. And I'm not mocking you for not bringing big Bibles. There's no reason to bring a big Bible usually. But look up 2 Samuel chapter 5, verses 6 through 8. David is anointed king of Israel, and he is now going through the promised land, conquering the cities that had been left unconquered in the book of Judges, Joshua. All right, so 2 Samuel 6, 5 verses 6 to 8. Chapter 5, verses 6 through 8. Sorry.
Now the king and his men went to Jerusalem against the Jebusites, the inhabitants of the land. And they said to David, "You shall not come in here, but the blind and the lame will turn you away."
Pause for just a second. What he means here is Jerusalem is so well defended that we could stock our garrison with blind men and lame men, and we would still beat you. Okay? It's a taunt.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
You stupid English.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Stupid English can get you smell of an elderberry. Yeah.
It was a
misprint. That's right. Exactly. We would get along well.
David cannot enter here. Nevertheless, David captured the stronghold of Zion, that is, the city of David. David said on that day, "Whoever would strike the Jebusites, let him reach the lame and the blind who are hated by David's soul through the water tunnel."
Okay.
Great.
So what David does, his strategy is, there's this huge wall, well defended. David goes in through the sewer, okay, or the water source, actually. It's actually the water supply. Goes up the water supply under the wall, and they all come in, his guys all come in, and they come up from behind the wall and conquer the Jebusites, okay? So great strategy, really cool. Sort of Lord of the Rings-ish, right? But Lord of the Rings came after, so Tolkien borrowed this in part from David. But here's the thing. It says that, therefore it was said that David's soul hates the blind and the lame, and they will not come into the house. Right? Says something like that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the house is the temple. Okay? There have developed a tradition that blind people and lame people could not enter the temple courts in Jerusalem. Okay. I'm just going to throw a little big Bible picture to you here and say what Bartimaeus is saying to Jesus, the mercy that he wants from Jesus, yes, is healing from his blindness. But he also wants to be able to enter the temple. Okay. For as long as he's been blind, was he born blind? Didn't say that, or
no? Well, it's just that recover my sight.
Recover. Okay, so that,
it sounds like to me that he had it
before. Time. Yeah, good point. So that's a good observation. So Bartimaeus, since he became blind, has not been able to go into the temple. Mm-hmm. So there's both a physical separation and a religious or spiritual separation that he wants to cure, and the only person who can cure it is the son of David, because David put the prohibition down. Okay? So that's just a little nugget for you that I think it's a fun little nugget there. 2 Samuel 5, verses 6 through 8. Okay, what else do you see?
Line 13 is called Rabbi.
Rabbi. Yeah.
The previous page was called teacher. Is that not the same word?
So in the Greek, it's not. But in reality, it's the same idea.
Okay.
Yeah. Teacher in the Greek is a sort of a generic teacher word. But when it says rabbi here, the Greek transliterates the Hebrew word. So in the Greek, it's Greek letters for the same sounds in Hebrew, rabboni.
Okay.
So, but in the previous, I'm saying this definitively, I didn't actually look it up. My guess is that previous, when it says teacher, it's didaskalos, person who teaches. And here it's rabboni, which is a transliteration of the Hebrew word.
Okay.
But they do make
into Greek and then English.
Yes. Right. Well, yeah. Yes. So we're reading an English translation that transliterates that's transliterating the Greek that was transliterating the Hebrew. Yeah.
It's also interesting that Bartimaeus didn't go up to him, up to Jesus, until they said, because they said, Jesus said, call him. And they said to the man, take heart, get up. He's calling you. And then he throws off his cloak and springs up and goes immediately to him. So before, he was just from afar.
Yeah, yeah.
And now he's like right up to him.
But what does that say to you, Andy? Like, what does that mean? Why?
I think he got the invitation.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't going to come to him until he got the invitation to come.
Yeah. But he was calling, still calling to Jesus.
Right.
Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me, right? He's calling out loudly. People tell him, shut up, shut up, shut up.
Right.
But when Jesus doesn't shut him up, but encourages him,
right, he springs up.
Yeah, I'll take it. I'll go.
Was it from you I recently learned the significance of him throwing off his cloak?
Probably not. What's the significance of him throwing off
his cloak? I've learned this recently, so I just assumed it was from you, but... The cloak was basically, like, throwing off his cloak is basically quitting his job.
Huh.
This cloak is the cloak of a beggar.
Okay.
And he threw it off and ran away from it with no eyesight or any reason he'd be able to recover it later.
Interesting. Good idea. Yeah.
I like and I don't remember where I heard that, but it was like within the last couple of weeks.
That's good. That sounds good to me.
When Pastor...
Yes,
when Beth. He was being... told to be silent, he had a boldness to keep shouting and saying what he wanted to say to Jesus.
Yeah, right. He did not listen to the crowd at all when they were telling him to shut up. He has something he wants from Jesus, and it's important. And he's not going to stop until he gets it, right? Yeah, good point. Good point.
It's also kind of a parallel when they were trying to bring the babies. And they would tell him, don't bother the teacher.
Yeah.
So it's again, don't bother him.
Okay.
And
yeah.
Once again, Jesus is like, no, bother me, really.
Exactly. Yeah. And in both cases, it's somebody that in society was considered worthless, mm-hmm. right?
Mm-hmm.
The children were considered worthless, but Jesus said, no, let the worthless children come to me. And here, a blind man is considered worthless. Mm-hmm. And Jesus said, no, let the worthless guy come to me. Yeah, so that's a great parallel. Very
and
well.
he does the same for women.
Not in this passage.
No, not in this passage, but like the children were also not in this passage. I'm saying it's another example of him saying, everybody come to me.
He welcomes women. He welcomes children. He welcomes the blind. He welcomes lepers.
Mm-hmm.
He welcomes tax collectors and prostitutes, Gentiles.
Samaritans.
It's hard to find someone Jesus doesn't welcome. There is, though.
The Pharisees,
right? The self-righteous religious people who don't want to listen, they get a hard pass from Jesus. Everybody else, come on in.
Going back before that, he's telling them that the way of the Gentiles is not going to be the way the church is going to be run. Because he tells them. You know that those who are considered rulers and the Gentiles lorded over them and the great ones exercise authority, but it shall not be so among them. So he's basically telling them that the church is not going to be run by them.
And he repeats the, but whoever is great among you must be your servant, whoever is the first among you must be slave of all, which is how we ended
the previous passage. Yeah.
But then he also tells him that he's going to, his life is going to be ransomed for many.
Okay, yeah. So lots of things to unpack there, right? One is, Jesus says, the reason I close my eyes is because this is so important to me, and it's one of my pet peeves, right? What Jesus says is, among you, you will not be the way things work in terms of governance among you is not going to be like it is among the Gentiles.
Mm-hmm.
And the Gentiles, they have lords who are over them. They exercise authority. There's a sense in which that's like partially exercising authority, right? Jesus says that will not be so among you. And that has the force, to my mind, and correct me if I'm wrong, that has the force of a command. This is not Jesus necessarily predicting, but it's Jesus commanding, right? Don't do that. They've been, they're jockeying for position. We talked about this jockeying for position in a previous passage, right? When they're trying to find he's talking about the children, but also there's the thing where he talks about, he's used the last verse earlier. It is in the previous passage. Many who are first will be last, and the last first. But there's also,
yeah, it was in the one before that too.
John and James looking to sit on the left and right, looking for powers and permission above the other.
So if you want one of those seats, don't wear solid golden pads.
On page 2, he sat down and called the 12, and he said to them, if anyone will be first, he must be last of all and servant of all. Remember, we were talking about this. We said, how many people does that include? Right? All. And they took a child and said, this child, to receive the kingdom like a child. So here, he's saying this must not, I'm going to say, he says shall. I think that shall is a shall of command. You shall not lord it over them. You shall not exercise authority over them. I wish that was a prediction, but it is a command. If it was a prediction, I think things would be very different for the church. Certainly through church history, there have been many church leaders who have lorded it over those under their care and who have harshly exercised authority over those under their care. I can think of a large number, a sadly large number of contemporary popular pastors who run the churches that they're serving as if their king and the church are their
vassals,
yeah, or subjects. I remember reading an article about this one popular pastor. You would know the name if I told you. And the article was talking about him, how nobody was allowed to talk to him. He had bodyguards for every service. Nobody was allowed to talk to him before or after the service unless they'd gone through the bodyguards, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, so, and I just wept when I heard it. I was like, this is just... This is the exact opposite of what Jesus said ought to be the case for those who are considered rulers in the church. He's going to say, he says right here, whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be the slave of all. I've said this before, and I don't want to embarrass our elders, but one of the things that just gets me about our elders is that they are servants. I'm going to pick on Chris because he's here, but I mean, Chris is one of our elders here at the church. And you know, one of the things that Chris does and has done since he's been part of church is he cleans the church, right? He started cleaning the church, not for any gain, because what gain is there in cleaning the church, right? But he just started cleaning the church because it was a way that he could serve. And we all recognize that this man is a servant. And so, of course, he's great among us, right? I could go down the line. We have 5 elders plus me. I could go down all 5 of them and say, these are guys whose first priority is to serve, right? I've had people in my career here who have come to me and said, I want to be an elder. I should be an elder in this church. And I look at their lives and I think, I don't think so, right? I don't see any area in which you're trying to serve people. And why would I put someone, why would I be part of putting you as an elder if you're not already trying to serve people? Because if you're not trying to serve people today, then when you're an elder, you certainly will not be serving them then. You'll just be using that as a position to lord over other people. So it's just, this is a pet peeve of mine, and I'm interpreting and applying all at once. So.
We say that would be is wants to be these days. Whoever wants to be, the word would be. Whoever wants
yes,
to
who
be
wants
great.
To be. That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Must be.
So there's nothing wrong about wanting to be great in the church. It's just you got to recognize how that happens. And it happens by being the slave of all. The slave of all. And you know what? Many people look at that and say, well, I guess I don't want to be great about you. I want to rule like a Gentile. And Chris pointed out earlier that Jesus says, the Son of Man, Jesus himself, came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. The word ransom there is it's a Bible word. There's a lot of ransoming in the Bible. And it always means paying a price to liberate someone from oppression. Okay. So maybe you've got a slave who someone comes in and pays the price for the slave to set them free. Maybe you've got someone who is in debt. A ransom is used for debt as well. Or maybe someone has committed a crime and someone else in their family pays the fine that allows them to go free from their punishment, okay? That's what the word ransom means in the Old Testament. It's a price that's paid to set someone free. And so that's what Jesus came to do, right? He came to give his life. His life is what he pays as a ransom to set free many.
Yeah. Good question. It should be pretty clear then to both James and John at this point that I'm come to serve and not to be sitting on a throne as a king.
Yeah.
I'm not 100% sure it was clear at that moment either, but
yeah.
I think he was speaking pretty clearly to them. I'm not here to be on a throne. I'm here to serve.
One of the fun things to do, if you want to look back at the history of Israel, one of the fun things to do would be to look at Deuteronomy chapter 17. You get the chance when you get home, read Deuteronomy 17. It's a set of laws for how the king ought to behave. If you have a king, this is long before they have a king. Long before they have a king, God says to the people of Israel, when you have a king, here's how he ought to behave. You'll see there's a lot of different regulations there about what the king's supposed to do and what the king's not supposed to do. And the idea, I'm going to interpret it for you. Read it for yourself, see if I'm right. The king is not supposed to do anything that makes him proud over other people. There's a definite sense that the king has to be underneath the law. You'll see something there that indicates that the king should be underneath the law, underneath God, and that his job is to serve the people of Israel and not to necessarily lord it over them. This idea of leadership is not new to Jesus. It's in the Old Testament as well, but Jesus makes it a regulation for the church. All right. So I asked you to, if you see certain things again, let me know.
Immediately.
Okay. So this is that's on line 14. Immediately he recovered his sight. Immediately is Mark's favorite word, especially in the first half of Mark. He's doing everything immediately.
And he asked the blind man again, what do you want me to do for you?
What do you want me to do for you? Okay, so that's for me. When I read that, I was like, okay, these stories belong together. The blind man, the story of the blind man is the mirror version of the story of the disciples, right? James and John come to Jesus and they say, we want you to do something for us. And he says, what do you want me to do for you? And they say, we want to be first in your kingdom. The blind man comes to Jesus. He says, what do you want me to do for you? And he says, Rabbi, he submits himself to Jesus. Let me recover my sight. The disciples are blind and they don't know it. Bartimaeus is blind, but he's willing to do he's willing to respond in faith, and he wants to recover his sight. So Jesus heals him.
It sounds like he wants to recover his sight so he can go to the house of worship.
Which
is a place to submit himself.
What makes you think that? I think you're right, but why would you say that?
Based on what you said earlier.
Okay. The text actually has a couple of indicators that what Bartimaeus wants is to go to Jerusalem. Why is that? What am I talking about?
Oh, didn't that bring us back to the whole reference of the Son of David?
Okay, so that's definitely a bit of it. Yeah, definitely a part of it is the Son of David. That indicates, that's clue number one, that what Bartimaeus wants is to go into the temple. There's another clue, though, that I'm driving at here. He
followed him on his way.
He followed him on Jesus' way.
He didn't just go off on his own.
Line 14, Jesus says to him, go your way. And in line 15, he follows Jesus on the way, which is his way. It was Jesus' way to Jerusalem. Jesus releases Bartimaeus to go wherever he wants, but Bartimaeus is now following Jesus to Jerusalem. So that's
and this is one of the people he didn't say follow me, because he said that to a lot of people.
Yeah. But Bartimaeus follows him, and that's the other word I wanted you to let me know if you saw it. Follow, right? Those who followed on page 5, line 9, were afraid, but here we have someone who follows boldly. Follows Jesus boldly. Good stuff there.
It's kind of like the rich
master.
Yeah,
because
right.
He didn't want to give up his riches.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Yeah, Beth, what do you got?
Yes, when Jesus says your faith has made you well, I think it goes back to line 7, where he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth.
Yeah, well, that's definitely. That's definitely an expression of his faith, right? That he believes that Jesus is not just Jesus of Nazareth, but he is Jesus, Son of David. And that's an expression of his faith, and he believes that Jesus has the ability to have mercy on him. So yeah, there's definitely faith that's involved there. Absolutely. We're going to stop observing. We have 10 minutes left, and we're going to do some interpreting. I want to give you 2 minutes. Think through this passage, look at what you've observed. I want you to write down in a sentence what you think the one of the main themes of this passage is. Okay, take 2 minutes and write down what you think this passage is trying to teach us tonight, or teach us and everybody from all time. All right, let's take a stab at some interpretation. What is a theme that you believe this passage is trying to teach? What's a theme that this passage is trying to teach? Joe.
Humility.
Humility. I'd like you to try to put it in words from the passage, base it on the passage. So where do you see humility being taught in the passage now? Let's try to describe it in that way.
The people who asked to be great, he said no. And the one who asked for mercy, he said yes. And in between that, he talked about how the church is not to follow the example of the Gentiles and Lord rulers, you know, and Lord authority over others. But that the leaders should be servants.
Good. All right. So what Joe has done is he's taken three components of the passage. The question about who can sit on Jesus' left and right hand, that request. Jesus' response about the rulers of the Gentiles lording it over them, but it will not be so among you. And Bartimaeus' humble request for healing, and it pulled that together and said, well, this is about humility. Okay. Now, humility is a topic, is a theme. Like a theme in the passage. What we want to do is to turn it into a principle. Let's use the word principle. Andy, what would you say?
If we follow Jesus, we must serve.
Yeah, okay, good. If we follow Jesus, we must serve.
Be servant leaders.
Servant leaders, yeah, right. Leaders in the kingdom are servant leaders.
So how about with the humility, if we come to Jesus humbly in our faith?
Yeah. If we come to Jesus
with humility, right?
If we come to Jesus in humility, or we come to Jesus humbly, he answers our prayers. Sure. I like that. Now, That's a little bit of a step away interpretively. Now he does say yes to Bartimaeus. Okay, is he going to say yes to every one of our prayers? Hard to make that case. What I will say is that if we want the Lord to answer our prayers, we must come to Him humbly. I think flip the sentence, and that makes it a lot more descriptive of what the Bible teaches us about prayer. But yeah, good point. Very good.
We may suffer as a result of our service.
Okay, yeah. Service of Jesus involves suffering. Absolutely. Yeah. Great. There's a lot more things we could pull out, but these are four good themes, five good themes that we've isolated here. Five good principles that this text is clearly teaching. Okay. Now, when I preach a sermon, I'll do a manuscript Bible study of the passage, work it through, and then I'll try to find what's the big one, right? What's the main point? And I want to try to preach the main point as often as possible. But there's always more than one point in the text. And so, but the key is it's got to be grounded in the observations. We got to make sure this is what the text is saying. It's not just what we wanted to say. Okay. Good stuff. Now we're going to apply. I want you to take each individually on your own. I want you to take a minute, and you have plenty of time at home if you want to do this more. But tonight we'll take a minute here, and I want you to just prayerfully listen to what the Lord has to say to you. Why did Jesus want you to hear this passage tonight? What's the difference it's supposed to make in your life specifically? Or It might not be the passage even. It might be something somebody said. It might be a thought that came through your mind while we were studying, and that's fine too. In the application, it's very personal. Take a minute, I want you to prayerfully listen, and I'd like you to try to write that down in a sentence. Right, not nearly enough time, but we're gonna work with what we have. As always, if you heard from God tonight, it's intensely personal. There's no need that you have to share it with us. But if you would like to share it, if there's something that God said to you that you feel would be of help to the rest of us to hear, I want to give you the opportunity to share your application tonight.
I thought of it this way. If I were to say to Jesus, what do you want me to do for you? Mm-hmm. How would I answer that question?
That's good.
And so I said, I came up with that I would like him to grant me a servant heart because I can be selfish and use me however you want and show me the way to serve you in your church.
That's awesome.
That's good stuff.
Love that. Somebody else?
We're on a road with challenges and potential suffering, but Jesus is leading the way.
Amen. And definitely, he goes before us, even in our suffering.
Yeah. And I'm afraid and amazed.
I'm afraid and amazed. Yep. For me, what really struck me was Bartimaeus springing up to come to Jesus. And what just struck me was, and again, it's not one of the major themes, but what struck me was I want to have the same eagerness to get to Jesus that Bartimaeus. So that was the thing that really struck me tonight. Anybody else? Very good. I encourage you, if you did hear something from God, I want you to make that part of your prayers this week. Right? Assume that God gave it to you for a reason and keep it in front of your eyes. If you feel like God didn't say anything to me tonight, why not? Why don't you just keep seeking his face? Maybe it's going to take some time. Meditate on the passage and on what we've talked about tonight. Again, as always, your homework is to read ahead and study ahead. Do some observations that will... It'll supplement our little 5 minutes that we have next week to observe specifically find where you think the next passage ought to end. Spoiler alert, they enter Jerusalem. So we're in Mark chapter 11. We're heading, crossing over to Mark chapter 11. Mark has 16 chapters. The last five chapters are all in Jerusalem. Six chapters, 11 through 16, are all in Jerusalem. So that's fully a third of the Gospel of Mark takes place in Jerusalem. So this is big stuff. If you want to look at proportions, we're getting to the point Mark wants to make, ultimately. All right, let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you this evening for this time we could have in your word. Thank you that you sent your Holy Spirit to fill us. Thank you for the word that you've spoken into our hearts. Lord, you've helped us to see, you've helped us to hear, and you're helping us to live what you have to say to us. So I pray that we would take what you've said to us and not let it fall to the ground, but incorporate it into our lives. Help me to spring into action when you call, Lord. And for the rest of us, Lord, whatever it is that you've said to us, help us to do that thing and to live out what you've said to us. Thank you that you are a God who speaks. Thank you that you are a God who cares, that you are not absent and remote, but you're here. Lord, I pray that you would speak to each of our hearts as we go our separate ways. Help us to grow into the people that you're calling us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. I'm going to stop the recording.